Before that can happen, however, cleaning is essential for wafers, as particles lurk at every stage in the manufacturing process. Before the copper is poured into the trenches for the interconnects, a barrier layer is applied. It helps to avoid short circuits and guarantees reliability. The trenches are then filled with copper.
Ada copper yang khas. Polishing.
Finally, the excess copper is ground down to the edges of the trenches. This insulates each interconnect from the others.
Interconnect means tosino. Okay, now.
A microchip made of copper wiring established GlobalFoundries as the first company in the world to adopt copper in volume production. A foundation for the state-of-the-art multi-core processors that GlobalFoundries is introducing today in all product areas. To keep us on the leading edge of the world's chip makers, electron microscopes constantly monitor every step in the manufacturing process, down to the atomic structures of each individual transistor.
This process must be in a small size.
In 2 months, the wafer is ready.
Huge
integrated circuits consisting of inductors with a length of multiple kilometers link up 100 billion transistors on numerous levels. And that, in a space no larger than a fingernail. GlobalFoundries, the first truly global semiconductor foundry, located in the USA and Germany. Fab 1 in Dresden and the future Fab 2 in Malta, New York. Together, they'll be two of the most advanced chip factories on Earth and a testing ground for the very latest microelectronic innovations from around the globe. The last production step in microprocessor manufacturing is the packaging of the chips. In preparation for this step, tin silver pellets are applied on the wafer. They will link the chip to the frame. Via the finest saw blades, the chips are cut off the wafer.
This is where microprocessors
the
are.
Method is used to bond the chip to the frame, which is sealed with a cover.
And this is the cover. That's what you have in the computers. That's it. See, all transistors are. That's it. So this company is 100% owned by UAE. You should be proud. And that gives you a very good relevance of this course, okay? So, this course is absolutely for you, okay? All right, good. So let me check something here. If it's working, then we are in good shape here. Let's see. Oops. All right, I have to use the keyboard then. In any case, so in this chapter, what we are going to study the properties of semiconductors. I'll tell you why in a second. If anybody knows, she can tell me, okay? So we are going to study those properties, the conductivity of all these things, and the doping. And then after that, we are going to... What we are going to do, we are going to study, after studying those, the conductivity and the doping and the concentrations, we are going to study the mechanism of the current flow, how the current is flowing in the semiconductors by the two phenomena in here, and then we touch base the PN junction, okay? That's basically what we are going to study in here. And I remind you to take notes, because not everything is in here. Take as much as you can, but keep looking and keep focusing on the class. Alright, semiconductors are basically materials, and we call them semiconductors because they are semi and conductors. So semi means what? Means half. And conductor, that means that they are half-half. They sometimes conduct, they don't conduct, means they are isolators. Good! And that's what we mean by that. Basically, the conductivity is the property, the physical property, that shows whether they are conducting or not. If that value is high, that means they are conducting. If not, they are not. All right, good. Those conductors, we have conductors like what? Copper, iron, metals, most of the metals. And the insulator, what we have, like glass, plastic. Huh? And even some plastics now, they can make them conductors, but generally speaking, they are not. And they are called usually polymers. In any case, there are many divisions of semiconductors. This is the most common one. There are semiconductors that are single element, means made out of one atom only. Like what? Like silicon or germanium. Okay? These are atoms that we know, and they constitute a semiconductor. That semiconductor has only one atom to make it. Like germanium and silicon. The other type would be what? Would be compound. Means that they are made out of two types of atoms or more. Like gallium arsenide, like aluminum gallium arsenide, etc., etc. They are compound, murakkab. Semiconductor that is compound. Okay, good. All right, good. So this is the division. There are other divisions. We will learn them about the semiconductors. But for now, we take that two types for now, and later we will see other types of semiconductors. All right. What we have in the semiconductor, we have atoms and we have also electrons. The first, we talk only about the most important stuff, which are the electrons. We have basically electrons called the valence bond, the valence electrons. And the valence electrons, they are the electrons that create the bonds. Which bonds? The covalent bonds. Covalent bonds, basically, they are chemical bonds, electronic bonds. But basically bond the atoms together, like silicons that you have seen before. They bring them together. Otherwise, they cannot make any material. So to make them, these atoms, they share electrons between them, and those electrons, they are called the valence bonds, okay? And those bonds, we call them covalent bonds. There are other bonds in nature, like ionic bonds that you find in the salt, for example, sodium chloride and other stuff. But these covalent bonds, they are very strong. They are really strong. It's not easy to break them. But, and what else? And they are most stable compared to other bonds, okay? So each electron, atom, as I said, will share an electron, and these two electrons, they create this bond between the atoms, okay? Without that, there's no bond. So to create a bond, you have to share. So that's the electrons and these bonds. Boom. This is what we have, okay? This is graphically what's happening in a silicon semiconductor. So a silicon atom has it's a shell. You know what means a shell? الغلاف الخارجي. A shell يعني الغلاف. You know, like a seashell, قطعة, for example. You see that one? So the seashell, the electronic shell of the silicon means the very last orbital, مدار الخارجي الأخير of the silicon, has four electrons, four electrons, and that's why it can make how many bonds? Four bonds. So this silicon will share with this silicon an electron. So these two electrons, they will create this bond that is called what? Covalent bond. Okay. And covalent, by the way, in Arabic is called the توافقية. We are in agreement. Okay. We are in business. Okay. And this atom again make bonds with this and this and this. So we have each silicon has how many neighbors? Jiran?
Four.
Okay. So each one of them has a bond with the other. That's it. So this is what a silicon semiconductor, a crystal, we call it in this case. It's a crystal. Why? لأنه it has the some special يعني تنظيم فضائي معين. It has a special, order, تناظر خاص ليه هو. We are not going to go there. It's part of crystallography. So we are not going to touch that. But in that space, each silicon has these four bonds. And that's all what we need to know. That's good enough. Okay. And that space, this order, we call it a lattice. We call it a lattice. يعني مصفوفة. Okay. A matrix, if you want. Boom. Now we are going to, little by little, build our knowledge of semiconductor. At low temperature, At low temperature means what? We are basically close to, what? 0 Kelvin. You know how much 0 Kelvin equals? How much? In the Celsius? Minus what? Around 273, 275. Okay? So around that, all covalent bonds are intact. Means they are there. They are not touched, broken, or anything. Okay? And the electrons? And no electrons are available for conduction. This is what? All the electrons, they are taken. Khalas. Nothing is available to move. They are all occupied in business. And the conductivity, therefore, zero. Means if we put this semiconductor in electric field, nothing will move. Then all electrons are busy making the bonds. As soon as we increase the temperature, at room temperature, how much is the room temperature?
20.
In Celsius, yes?
20.
Close.
20?
25, exactly. Or 300 Kelvin. Close by, okay? But for now, the convention is 25. Okay? Room temperature, remember? It's 25. And usually I put it in the exam sheet. So that means 300 Kelvin. So at that temperature, means as we increase it, what will happen? Some covalent bonds, they will break. Because what happens as we increase the temperature? What happens? Who vibrates? No, not the electrons. The what? The what? I did it. The atoms. That's what it vibrates. Yeah, that's what vibrates. As we heat it, so the atoms, actually they are vibrating, but as we increase the temperature, we increase their vibration. They will vibrate more because that means they have gained more energy. Do you understand? As they vibrate, what happens if you take a wire and twist it and do like this? What will happen to the wire?
Break.
That's it. So that wire will break. The bonds also will break. So some covalent bonds, they will what? Break. And when they break, boom, the electron now is freely moving. It can move. That electron can easily move. Boom. And what makes it move is the break of these bonds. Is because of this energy, the thermal energy we give to the semiconductor, that makes that bond break, makes that electron loose. Loose means go without any force to attract him or to get it stuck. Okay? So now the electrons are free, so now if I put an electric field, the electron will move one way or another. So that means conductivity is not zero, it's higher, yes or no? So you see, conductivity is zero, greater than zero. That's semiconductor. That's what we mean by semiconductor. Here is completely isolated, here is a conductor. Do you understand? See, simple things. Good. Alright, let's keep going. And that's what happened graphically. We bring this. Now, what happens actually, when the electrons now move out of the one of the silicon atoms, it leaves behind it a hole. A hole is like, we don't know exactly physically what it is, but it's something that is fictitious, something that it has physical properties. We don't know exactly what it is, but it behaves like a positive charge. Why? Because this silicon was neutral at the beginning, yes or no? Boom. And then suddenly, this electron, under the electric field, boom, after this has broken, goes away. So we need something to tell us that this electron has moved. And that is the hole. It's a positive charge, basically. Physically speaking, nobody knows exactly what it is, but it behaves like a positive charge. Boom. All right. So that hole now stays in this silicon, and this electron moves. This hole does not stay there, actually. It also moves from this atom to another atom because it doesn't make any bond. There's no bond that fixes this hole. So that hole also will move from one atom to another. Okay? Because it doesn't make any bond. And now we have two types of charge that are moving freely, the electrons and the holes. Yes? Good question. Is as soon as we break the bond, it means at room temperature, at higher temperature, as soon as we are off the low temperature, which is the 0 Kelvin, as soon as we go there up and we break the bond, as soon as we do that, the electron moves, the hole moves. We create, basically, as we break the bomb, we create an electron and a hole at the same time. Okay? Good question. All right? Put your mobile in your parcel and don't use it. You have a mobile?
No.
What's that? You're writing on your lap? Put on the table, please. Ah, you see? All right, thank you. So, done with that. So now, as soon as we break a bond, we are creating one hole and one electron. So the number of electrons and holes are? Boom. That's the first observation. Okay? And what else? We call these kind of semiconductors, they are intrinsic. What means intrinsic? It means their charge, their electrons and holes, it comes from their own atoms. Asliya. Intrinsic, okay? And we call this phenomenon of creating electrons and holes by breaking the bonds, we call it generation. خلق. عملية تخليق. Alright, good. So, this generation has a speed. It's not speed like walking here. We cannot call it like that. So we call it a rate. نسبة التخليق. The generation rate. Okay, good. Alright. Now there's something else. When an electron is moving around, is free, after breaking the bond, he meets a hole. That means, hey, hello, we need you back. As soon as they meet, that electron stops to be free, and we call it, basically, when it stops to be free, that means, in the list of free electrons, I have one gone. Because now it's not anymore free. Now it's attached to an atom. In that case, we call it is gone, we call it recombined. It recombines with the holes and now it's not free anymore. خلاص? That recombination is opposite to generation. الفناء, recombination, okay? Annihilation, okay? And it has also a rate, speed, kind of speed, but we call it a rate, because we are not really running fast or something like that. So, the generation, is affected, or maybe affected, is partly affected by thermal energy. As we heat more, we break more, we have more free electrons and holes. Yes or no? So that's what we mean by here, okay? So, generation, of course, the recombination in this case, will be dependent on the temperature. So the temperature is controlling that. That means if we want more, we heat more. But is that a good idea? Let's think about it in a second. So, as we said, that the thermal generation of these electron hole pairs is basically create equal concentration of holes and pairs, and holes, electrons and holes. So, this is a fact. This is what we know for sure. And we said that, okay, but that's it. And generation recombination rates, of course, in equilibrium, what we mean by equilibrium means when things are stable. خلاص. We create, something happens, create, and then there is a recombination after a certain time, then things are get steady. Whatever is created will be equal to what dies out. Because they cannot keep creating, like generating forever. A process will bring that down to a certain level where everything is stable. The number of electrons and holes is stable at that temperature. We call that temperature the equilibrium temperature. And at that time, the generation and recombination, they get equal. And everybody is happy. Good? Like your friend said, please ask questions. There's absolutely no stupid question. I'll be stupid if I do answer stupidly. Okay? And I don't like that, and I don't do that. Okay? So ask as much as you want. Okay? The first equation in this course is this equation. And what is that? It's basically, we are not going to see how we got this equation, but it's given to us by what we call solid-state physicist. The physicist who studied this kind of semiconductors theoretically and also experimentally, they gave us this equation thanks to that. And what does it mean? It means, okay, let's read one by one. Any equation we write, we have to define the parameters inside. So Ni is basically the number of free electrons and holes in a unit of volume. معنى to ايش? كثافة الشحنات, okay? Of what? Of holes and electrons, electrons and holes, which are basically the same, yes or no? For an intrinsic semiconductor, that's why we have this I. I means intrinsic. Take notes, huh? All right. And B is a constant parameter, is equal to this value, blah, blah, and this unit. Every value, every parameter must have a value and a unit. And this takes me to another fact. If you write your answer in an exam or anything without a unit, you're losing half of that. Okay? In other words, unit is very important. Why? Because I gave this example last year and every year. 5 eggs and 5 watermelons. If 5 or 5? But 5 eggs, I can't get them in one hand, yes or no? But 5 watermelons, they will crush me. Yes or no? Watermelon, I cannot take one, let alone 5. So 5 and 5, they are 5, yes or no? But the unit make a big difference, yes or no? Yeah. So unit is very important. Don't make any mistake. Any value without any number, any answer, numerical answer without the correct unit, goodbye to that. All right, the temperature here is measured in Kelvin. We know the conversion, the Kelvin to 273 plus blah, blah, etc. Okay, EG here is the band gap energy. For silicon is 1.11 electron volt. Electron volt is another unit of energy. What's the unit of energy in physics? Joule, yeah, electron volt is another unit. And there is a conversion between joule and electron volt. It's not the time to talk about that, you know that. And K is a constant, it's called Boltzmann constant. And it has a value and, of course, unit. Boom. So, with these parameters, I can get basically at a given temperature in the equilibrium, the concentration or the density of electrons, which is the same as holes in the intrinsic semiconductor. Okay? Boom. So, give me the temperature, I give you the density. Alright, so why not if we want to increase the conductivity, we need to increase the number of electrons and holes, yes or no? So in this case, why don't we use the heat to create these electrons and holes? Why not? If I'm more conductivity, I heat more. First of all, this has two issues. Because actually at room temperature, that number, and technically speaking, if you and you will appreciate that later, that number of electrons and holes, it's not that big. It's not useful to make a very good conductivity. And also, if we want to create a conductor, a very conductor at room temperature, we need to heat. So do you think we have to heat all the transistors to make it work? Mm-hmm. It will be, first of all, stupid, and second of all, not practical. Okay? So this is the thing, and engineers are not stupid, are smart people, okay? And you are smart, okay? So, the answer to this problem, to increase the conductivity, is that we have to use another trick here, and that trick is doping. And what is doping? Have you heard about the word doping? What's doping? Who heard about doping? Not in semiconductors. What's making them?
Arabic
munashitat. Munashitat, sorry. What is it? Yeah. Okay, express yourself. So basically what they do, they inject in their bodies. Sahwalala. Munashitat. They inject. Swallow wallah with needles. Sahwalala. And they make their performance higher. Same story. We dope the semiconductor now with something to make what? To increase the number of electrons or holes, depending on what we want, and make it higher and higher, to increase the conductivity. Same story. We inject. Very good. So, but in our case, we inject with atoms. We inject the silicon crystal with atoms. And that's the definition, really, word by word, is the intentional means we do have the control of that. We want it. We do it. We have process for that. We are not going to spend too much time. We call it ion implementation, we call it diffusion. There are many techniques for that. We inject these atoms, we call them impurities. You see, I didn't write that. If you don't take note, good luck. Okay? So these atoms that we inject into the crystals, we call them impurities. Shwe'eb. Why we call them shwe'eb? Because they are not part of the crystal. They are outsiders. Foreigners. Like me, for example, in UAE. I'm a foreigner. But I'm here to enhance the knowledge here. Do you understand? So, Antum al-Asr, I'm a foreigner. One day I have to leave. But you have to take the knowledge, okay? Good enough? Awesome. So that's the impurities. Okay, because they are, it's not because they are bad. We call them impurities just because they are not part of the crystal. You understand? They are outsiders. Okay. So we put them intentionally, it means we control that. And why? To change the carrier concentration. To increase the carrier concentration. What do you mean by carrier? Every charge is basically a carrier. حملت للشحنة. What they are exactly, we don't know. We call them that way because they move. They move the charge. That's why we call them charge carriers. So we call them carriers or charge. We know what we are talking about. Bingo. And then for that matter, when we dope now the semiconductor, we either push the number or the density of the electrons higher or the density of the holes higher. We'll see how that. So, to make basically a semiconductor with higher density of electrons, more electrons than holes, we create a semiconductor that we call it N-type. Why N-type? Because the majority carriers, they are negatively charged, and that's why N comes in. Okay, it means the electrons are the majority free carriers. They can move freely, okay? And the other type of semiconductor we can make with this doping, of course, each one will dope it differently. And we'll see how. The other type of semiconductor is called the P-type. Why? Because the charge that are majority and they can move freely, they are the holes, the positive charge, and that's why we call them P-type. Alright, for the N-type, to make an N-type semiconductor, the impurity that we inject inside has, in addition to 4 electrons in the outer shell, it has 1 extra. So that impurity will make will take a place of silicon and will make 4 bonds and will have 1 extra one that is free. I create the 4 bonds and I have 1 extra. It can go anywhere it wants. Okay? So we call those donors. Why we call them donors? Because they donate. It's bar'u.
Okay, tafadhali. So where did the silicon go?
Go somewhere else. Go somewhere else. Between other atoms. That's a good question. Okay, it can go between other atoms because the crystal itself is not pure. There are some places that are vacant, so it can be kicked out, and then the silicon will go there, and the impurity will take its place, and everybody is happy. Or sometimes it will be squeezed between the atoms, and that's it. Good luck with that. But that impurity will have to take a place of that atom to make the bonds. Okay, so that extra electron will be free to move, and atoms like what? Atoms like phosphorus has 5 electrons. Go to Mendeleev table. You know Mendeleev table? The atom table? Go there and check. You will find that phosphorus, the final shell, the last shell, electron shell, has basically 5. And in the column where phosphorus is, all those, they have 5. Okay? That means all this we can use. Okay? So phosphorus, we call it in this case a donor, متبرع. Okay. The other case of creating a P-type semiconductor, we need to do what? We need to create 3 bonds. So an atom, an impurity comes, and we'll have only 3 in the shell. We'll create 3 bonds, and the other silicon, I need to get a bond with that one. I need to have 4, yes or no? So I get that electron from another silicon, I will tell him, I need that electron, I grab it, I steal it, and we'll create a bond with my neighbor. So that silicon basically lose what? Will lose an electron for the impurity to make an extra bond, yes or no?
Yeah.
So that that silicon will have what? A hole, yes or no? Yeah. So that hole now can move everywhere between atoms. And this way, we create hole, yes or no? So as you can see, in this case, in the N-type semiconductor, we created an electron without hole, yes or no? And in the P-type, we created a hole without electron. So with this one, we create more electrons, and that's why they are called N-type, freely moving. And in here, I create more holes that there is no electron free. Here I put only holes. So we will talk about what's next in the next slide, okay? So that's basically what we have been talking now, okay? So this, like we didn't mention before actually, we have to mention something, like an example of the, here we call them ax- acceptors, because these impurities, they do accept an electron from another silicon. Huh? We call them acceptors. Huh? Acceptors, what is that? Acceptors, it's not red, you can make it red. Like what? Like boron. If you go to the boron, left side of Mendeleev table, boron has in the shell three electrons. And whatever in that column is the same. They have three electrons there. So that's the trick, you know. And engineering is actually the science of tricks. Ilm al-Hiyal, invented by the Arabs, by Ibn Musa al-Shaker in Basra, long time ago. But anyways, we all learn from each other. So this is what we have been speaking about. That's it. So this boron will get an electron from somebody, somewhere, you know, will steal it to create an extra bond, and that silicon will basically lose and create a hole. That's it. So that's basically what it is in here. All right, let's keep moving. Now things will get a little bit spicier as we move. So, let's see. At room temperature, we said that some bonds, they get broken, yes or no? So even in a P-type semiconductor, although we have holes, we do have also electrons. Where they come from? They come from the broken bonds, yes or no? Because we have broken bonds at room temperature, yes or no? Okay? So, but what we say? But we have the number of holes, actually, technically speaking, is much greater than those broken bones or those intrinsic charge. Okay? So, Na here denotes what? What we mean by Na? Na is basically the density of the acceptors. Okay? I'm not sure if I have written that in previous slide. It should be. Let's see. Oops. Let me up. Okay, let's see. Did I mention here? No, I didn't mention that. That's fine. So, Na here, what we mean by Na is the density of acceptors. Na is the density of acceptors, means the density of the borons in this case. If that density is much greater than Ni, means it has enough density, then basically the concentration of acceptors, so basically the number of holes is basically the same as these borons, okay? And that's what we mean by this equation. And here I want you to take note here. When we write here P, we mean that P, the holes, yes or no? The holes in a P-type semiconductor is almost the same as the, here we are talking about density, or we can talk about density and number as well. So the density of holes, or the number of holes in a P-type semiconductor, is exactly the same as the number of borons, because they come from the borons. Of course, there is some little bit holes that come from where? From these, from the intrinsic, from the bones that are broken. But we said that usually, really, the density of the acceptors is much greater than these broken bones. That's why the majority, the holes here, they are almost equal to the borons, basically, because each boron will give me holes. So in reality, if I write that seriously, so if I write here, what's this? How is that? Pen is not working here. So if I write really here, so here, if I write it correctly, let's see, let me see here, can I write that? It's not working. Somebody will teach me later. So the holes really in this P-type semiconductor, in reality, if I want to write the exact equation, it comes from the acceptors, yes or no, plus the, what? The broken bones, yes or no? Because each broken bone will give you one hole, yes or no? So this is the number of broken bones, plus the borons that created these holes. But if this is much bigger than this, so what can I say? I can ignore this, yes or no? Yes or no? So I can ignore this and say, you know what? The holes is almost equal to the borons. That's what it is, nothing more. Okay? Because the holes, they are coming either from broken bones or from my acceptor, yes or no? Good. So that's what we mean by that, okay? So here, when we talk about number, if we take these numbers and divide them, really seriously, by the volume to get the density, we are talking about density. Now these, they become densities, okay? So that's why, actually, and you have to pay attention here, when we are talking about here, we are not talking about the numbers, we are talking about densities, because numbers are not really important. What is really important is the density of the charge. Okay? So that's why when we talk numbers, it's the same as we talk about densities. Okay? Good. Alright, any question, huh? Stop me anytime, okay? I don't like to talk like a crazy person. Okay. Alright, good. So let's see, let's keep going. The same thing for the donors. Ah, very good. Usually the donor's density also is much, much bigger than the intrinsic number of charge. So in that case, again, the electrons, the density of the electrons in the n-type, again, this we call it in English subscript. Okay? The subscript tells me which type of semiconductor. So this means the negative charge, which means the electrons in the n-type semiconductor, is almost the same as the donor's density, because the same analogy that we did here, it applies also on the electrons. So I will write here like in electrons, if I may, let's see, electron different. So I say the electrons in the n-type, this is n, let's see here, this is n, I write n terribly. So here, if I want to write the exact equation, it would be nd, because the donors create these electrons, plus some electrons, ni, they got from, we got from where? From the broken bonds, okay? But if we take, and this is a reality, it's a fact, like it's numbers they are speaking here, the donors are much, much bigger than the broken bonds. That's why usually we can ignore these, and we say that the density of electrons in an n-type semiconductor is the same as the donor's density. Bingo. Okay? That's what it is. Alright, back to our business here. Alright, so... okay, very good. So that's the key now. See? Now, because of the doping, we can control now the density of the electrons or the holes. See? That's the key. So we are not dependent on temperature anymore. It's very hard to control temperature. What do you mean? Take temperature and try to... it's crazy. So this way, we have a good control over the density. Now we come to the second most important equation in this course, which is the golden rule. In any semiconductor... By the way, there's another... I'm not sure if I have said that here. But there's a name. Now, when we get the electrons from doping, from dopant, so the boron and the phosphorus, the acceptors or the donors, they are called impurities. And these impurities, when we put them in semiconductor and they are impurities, we call them dopant. Okay? The process, العملية, we call it doping. But itself, the impurity, we call it dopant. Okay? Dopant, like this. Okay? Dopant. Dopant. المنشط. Okay? Dopant. D-O-P-A-N-T. Do you understand? Dopant. So the dopant makes the semiconductor, we call it, extrinsic. Means the majority or the carriers here, in this case, the holes in P-type, these holes that are in the P-type, they are extrinsic. They are not from the silicon. They are mainly from the dopant. And we call this semiconductor, this is another definition, or another division, we call it extrinsic semiconductor. It means it's semiconductor made by the dopant, not from the silicon. So, this extrinsic semiconductor, so whether the semiconductor is extrinsic, like it's made by the impurities, or intrinsic, made by the silicon, they follow this rule. This is the golden rule of semiconductors. Means what? It says that the hole density times the electron density in any semiconductor in p-type, and later on we'll see in n-type, is equal to ni squared. Always. If we have an n-type semiconductor, we have a similar equation, which is the electrons in an n-type times the holes in an n-type is equal to ni squared. It's the same equation. The only thing difference is that which type of semiconductor, n-type or p-type. So back to the p-type, let's see. Okay, good. So if we multiply these two, we get ni squared. We know how much this the holes in the p-type, they are almost equal to the donors, yes or no? So the minority here, we call them minority, the electrons in a p-type, they are less than the holes, yes or no? They come from where, these electrons? They come from the broken bonds, yes or no? In a p-type, okay? In a p-type semiconductor, we have, in addition to the holes, we have also electrons, but they don't come from the dopant. They come from where? From the broken bonds, yes or no? So these electrons, we call them minorities. They are aqalia. They are the majority of the free carriers, the free charge. They are actually holes. That's why we call this a p-type semiconductor. See, p-p. So these majority, we will mention that again, don't worry. So these ones, we know how much. They are equal to Na, yes or no? So Np means the electrons in a p-type. They are equal to Ni squared over Na, which is this one, yes or no? Because pp is almost equal to Na, yes or no? We just studied that. Means the holes in a p-type semiconductor, they are equal almost the density of the acceptors, okay? That's it. The same story goes with the electrons. With the holes in an n-type, sorry. So we use the same equation, but now in an n-type. Now in n-type semiconductor, these are the majority, yes or no? They are electrons. We know how much they are equal. They are equal to Nd, yes or no? So Pn, the holes in an n-type, which are minority, they are equal to Ni squared divided by this value, which is Nd. Very good. So here, the holes in an n-type, or the electrons in a p-type, they are called the minority, and they are depend. This is constant. Nd and Na, they are constant. So these, they depend on the temperature, because Ni depends on the temperature. Because yes, this minority, they are created by breaking the bonds. You see, this is the proof that minorities are created by breaking the bonds. Almost there, it's time almost for the class to stop. Here we just put the summary of what we studied today. So basically we have the p-type semiconductor, n-type semiconductor. So these, the np, which is the electrons in a p-type semiconductor, they are dependent on temperature because of Ni squared. You see, we just saw the equation for that. And the same thing for the holes in an n-type semiconductor. They are dependent on Ni squared. Basically, they are generated by the broken bonds. So pp, or the holes in a p-type, they are called majority charge carriers. Okay, you see here? They are called majority carriers. The same thing for the electrons in an n-type. They are called, what is that? They are majority here, I see. They are majority carriers. And pp, also, they are majority carriers. But np, they are called minority carriers, okay? Aqalliya, mustadaf, okay? The same thing for the holes in n-type. They are also minority. These are typical values, okay? You see here, the majority carriers, they are in the order of 10 power 14 per centimeter cubic. But the minorities here, the holes in n-type, they are in the order of 10 power 9. See how many zeros difference? 5. 100,000 times. It's a big difference. That's why these ones are majority, really. These are nothing. They can crush them. And the same thing in here. But again, here also, you see, it's almost same order. The 14 majority and 16 majority. You can see the order of magnitude here for the pp. For the np here, for the electrons in p-type, same order almost there. It's 10 power 9. See, here is actually between them, how many zeros? 7 zeros. 7 zeros are taking 10 million times the majority here compared to the minority. And we stop here today, and then we take attendance. Okay? Any question? So inshallah, see you next class.